hello and welcome to the lesson. And in this lesson, we'll be covering primitive data types in Java. So primitive data types are the basic building blocks of any programming language, and they are used to store simple values such as numbers, characters, and Boolean values. We will also learn how to declare and initialize variables in Java. So during this lesson, we will discuss the following topics. The first one is the explanation of primitive data types and their uses. Then we'll discuss integer data types like byte, short, int, long. Then we'll go through floating point data types like float or double. We'll also discuss character and Boolean data types. We'll see the demonstration of how to declare and initialize variables of different primitive data types. And for sure, we'll also discuss the casting. So, variable declaration. Variable declaration in Java is the process of specifying the data type and name of a variable that will be used to store a value of a certain type. It informs the compiler about the name and type of the variable before it's used in the program. For example, the declaration of an integer variable named h will look like this. So, as you can see on the demo one, is just int h. And this informs the compiler that an integer variable named h will be used in the program. But it doesn't actually assign a value to the variable. The initialization is required to assign a value to the variable. So let's now discuss the variable initialization. So the variable initialization in Java is the process of assigning an initial value to a declared variable. It can be done at the time of declaration or later in the code. It is important to initialize a variable before using it in the program, as accessing an uninitialized variable can result in errors or in just unexpected behavior. So here is an example of variable declaration and initialization in Java, as you can see on the demo 2. So first line is the declaration int age, and the second line is the variable initialization, age equals 25. So in the code of the demo 2, we first declare an integer variable called age using the int keyword, and then we initialize it with the value 25 using the assignment operator equals. So now the variable age has been declared and initialized to the value 25. We can rewrite this code in just a single line in the following way. So as you can see on the demo 3, int age equals 25 is written in a single line. So there are 8 primitive data types in Java: byte, short, int, long, float, double, char, and Boolean. And each of these data types serves a specific purpose and has a specific range of values it can hold. On the current screen, you can see the list of all the primitive data types, their sizes, and their ranges of values they can hold. Okay, so let's check the following example. Let's create a file called example1 in the package you desire. So I will create the file in the section 3.lesson1. So let's right click new Java class, and here let's type example1 and click enter. So as you can see, the example file is created. Let's create the main method. In order to do that, you need to write the following: public static void main string arguments, and we'll discuss how to do it later. We'll discuss the methods, we'll discuss how to declare them, what exactly are methods in our future lessons. So let's not waste time on it, and let's directly go to the primitive data types for now. Okay, so let me copy paste some template code. So here you can see all the comments for all the data types. If you remember, after two slashes, every character that comes after the two slashes is comment. So the following line is just a comment. It will be ignored. So we can write whatever we want here, and it will not break the execution or the compilation. First, let's start with the byte data type. And the byte data type can store a whole number between minus 128 and 127. And it requires only one byte of memory. An example of declaring and initializing a variable of the byte data type would be the following. So let's write it here. Byte h equals 25. So here we declare and initialize the variable called h of the data type byte with the value 25. Let's proceed. The short data type can store a whole number between the following value and the following value, and it requires 2 bytes of memory. And an example of declaring and initializing the variable of type short will be the following. So let's write short, for example, year equals 2024, for example. So here we declare and initialize the variable called year. The data type is short, and the value assigned to the variable year is 2024. The int data type can store a whole number between the following values, as you can see here, and it requires 4 bytes of memory. An example can be the following. Int population equals, let's put 1 million. And in this case, we declare the variable called population of type int with the value 1 million. The long data type can store the number between the following values, and it requires eight bytes of memory. An example is the following: long distance equals a very large number. So the distance is the following. As you can see here, the compiler argues because the value is too large to be placed in the long. So let's reduce the amount of zeros. So now it can fit the long. And it's important to note that if a value exceeds the range of a certain type, it will result in a compile time error. This is what I just actually shown. And therefore, it's important to choose the appropriate data type based on range of values that the variable needs to store. So that concludes our discussion on integer data types in Java. And in the next part, we'll be discussing the floating point numbers in Java. A floating point data type is a type of data that can store decimal values. And there are 2 types of floating point data types in Java. The first one is float, and the second one is double. And the difference between the two is the size of the number that they can store. The float data type is a single precision 32-bit floating point. It can hold a value from the following to the following. So the range is pretty huge, as you can see. And it T's represented by the keyword float. So here's an example of how to declare the float variable. Let's define it. Float weight equals 68.5, and we need to use the letter F. So please note that we added the letter F to the end of the number to indicate that it is a float. If you don't add the F, the compiler will assume that it's a double. So let's proceed with the double data type. So this data type, on the other hand, is a double precision 64-bit floating point. So it can hold a value in the following range, as you can see here on the screen. And let's take a look at the example. So double height equals 178.6, for example. So in this case, we declare a variable called height of the type double, and the value is 178.6. And by default, Java considers decimal numbers as double. So we don't need to add a letter at the end of the number to indicate that it's double. And in general, you should use the double data type if you need more precision in your calculations. However, keep in mind that using double can lead to larger memory usage. So if memory is a concern, it's best to stick with float. And now that you understand the difference between float and double, you should be able to choose the appropriate data type for your needs. So let's discuss the character and boolean data types. And these data types are also considered primitive in Java, just like the integer and floating point data types we covered in the previous parts of this lesson. So a character data type, also known as char, is used to store a single character, such as a letter, number, or symbol. The char data type is declared using the keyword char and can be initialized with a single character enclosed with a single quotes. For example, let's take a look. Char grade equals A. So in this case, we declared the variable called grade, the type is char, and the value is character A, that is uppercase. It's important to note that char values can also be represented by their corresponding Unicode values. For example, the Unicode value for the letter A is 65. So we could also initialize the char variable as char grade 2 equals 65. So that's it regarding the char data type. Let's move on to the boolean data type that is used to store true or false values. The boolean data type is declared using the keyword boolean and can be initialized with the values true or false. For example, let's take a look. Boolean is student equals true. So, for example, this variable will store the value whether someone is student or not. So we called it isStudent. And it can store only true or false values. In our case, we assign the value true to it. So the variable name is isStudent. The data type name is boolean. And the value we assigned to this variable is true. And both char and boolean data types are important for certain situations in programming, such as when working with character sets and logic statements. And it's important to understand when to use these data types and how to correctly declare and initialize variables of these types. And it's Important to note that variable names must start with a letter, dollar sign, or underscore, and it should not contain any spaces or special characters. Also, variable names are case sensitive. We will discuss the naming conventions later in our future lessons. Let's now discuss the casting in Java. So in Java, casting is the process of converting one data type to another. It is important to note that casting can only be done between compatible data types. For example, you can cast a float to an int, but you cannot cast a boolean to an int. There are two types of casting in Java: explicit casting and implicit casting. Let's start from the explicit casting. The explicit casting, also known as type casting, is when you explicitly specify the data type you want to convert a variable to. This is done by placing the desired data type in parentheses in front of the variable. For example, if we have a variable of type float with the value of 3.14 and we want to convert it to an int, we will write the following, as you can see on the demo 4. Float f equals 3.14. F at the end determines that this is a float type, and we will discuss it later, so feel free to ignore it for now. The second line is int e equals int in parentheses f. So in this example, we are explicitly casting the float variable f to an int variable e. And it's important to know that when you explicitly cast a floating point number to an integer, the decimal part will be truncated. So as a result, e will contain just 3. Let's now discuss the implicit casting, also known as type promotion. So it is when the compiler automatically converts a smaller data type to a larger data type without the need for explicit casting. For example, if we have a variable of type byte and we assign it to a variable of type int, the compiler will implicitly cast the byte to an int. So let's take a look at the demo 5. Here in the first line, we declare and initialize the byte variable b with value 10. And in second line, we declare and initialize the variable I. So in this example, we are implicitly casting the byte variable b to an int variable I. And it's important to note that when you use the implicit casting, you can run into issues if the value of the smaller data type is too large to fit into the larger data type. In such cases, the value will be truncated and you may lose some information. So in summary, casting is a powerful tool in Java that allows you to convert one data type to another. However, it's important to be aware of the potential issues that can arise when using implicit casting, and to use explicit casting when necessary. So that's it, and thank you for attention, and see you on the next lesson. Bye.